Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends. So in this topic, we are going to talk about what are the physical as well as the chemical properties of the boron. And as we know that boron is the first element of the group 13. And that's the reason we are going to talk about the physical as well as the chemical properties of it. So now, let us start with that. So here we are going to talk about the physical property as well as the chemical property of boron. So let us start with the first one, that is the physical properties of boron. So as you know earlier, that is as we have discussed earlier also, that is the boron is the one which is the first element of the group 13. And that's the reason that its atomic size is also less as well as the electronegativity is also more compared to the other elements belonging to the same. So that's the reason that it will exhibit different kind of property compared to that of the other one. So let us start with the physical property, and those are starting with the first one, that is boron is a non-metal and black colored solid. So this is the something that I want to talk about, that is boron is actually very hard substance, and because it is a non-metal, and that's the reason while talking about the other elements that are belonging to the same group 13 except boron, they have some kind of metallic property or metallic characteristic, but this is somewhere it is a non-metal. So this was the first point that I was talking about, and now let us move on to the next one, and that is it has higher melting point and it is a poor conductor of electricity. Obviously, because it is a non-metal, so obviously it will be a poor conductor of electricity. And now, let us talk about the melting point. As we have discussed earlier also, that is the boron is the one which has a smaller atomic size as well as higher electronegativity. So because of this, what happens is, it has a very much a strength, and that's the reason that it is very hard. And that's the reason that we have to provide more amount of energy so as we could melt it. So that is the reason it has higher melting point compared to that of the other elements belonging to group 13. So now, let us move on to the other physical properties. So these are the few physical properties that I was talking about, and there is the last one that I want to talk about, that is crystalline boron. As we have discussed earlier also, that is crystalline boron is unreactive, while talking about the amorphous is actually reactive. So as we also have discussed in our previous topic, that is when we are talking about the chemical properties of or anomalous behavior of the boron, and in that case we have got to know that crystalline boron is basically non-reactive with the water molecule. While talking about the amorphous, it can be reactive, and most of the boron which is basically amorphous in nature, that are reactive compared to that of the crystalline boron which is basically non-reactive. So these were the physical properties that I was talking about, and now let us move on to the next one, that is the main thing, that is chemical properties of boron. So now here we are going to talk about the different chemical properties that have been exhibited by the boron. So in this case, we are going to talk about the reactions that we have did in our earlier topic also, as well as there will be some kind of reactions that will be neutrals in terms of the chemical property of boron. So now let us start with the first one, that is action of air. So what is the action of air on boron? As we know that air consists of oxygen as well as it consists of nitrogen also. So mainly we are talking about here oxygen. So that's the reason that what will happen if oxygen is being treated with boron. So it has been found that whenever the boron is treated with oxygen and with a particular temperature, that is here it is 973 Kelvin. So in that temperature basically it forms an oxide. So therefore this is what we have, that is boron oxide. So that is B2O3. So this has been formed when boron is being treated with or boron undergoes oxidation at high temperature. And this is the first reaction that I was talking about, and this is the chemical property. So now let us move to the next property, and that is the reaction of boron with NaOH. So basically boron is also very much reactive to alkali, and in this case it is also very much reactive to that of that is NaOH. And since we know that boron is a very hard material, and that's the reason we have to dissolve it in aqueous solution of that is NaOH at high temperature. So what we have to do is we have to dissolve boron, or we have to add boron in NaOH aqueous solution, and that's the reason that we have to fuse it, or we have to give tremendous temperature to that, so that we could liberate that is H2 gas, as well as the product that we could obtain, it will be basically sodium orthoborate that has been having a formula, that is Na3BO3. So this is something that I was talking about, and so this is the second property that I have mentioned when a boron is being treated with a base like NaOH. So now let us move on to the next property, and that is reaction of boron with nitrogen. And as we know that this is the thing that we have discussed earlier also, but in air basically oxygen as well as nitrogen is also present. So in the previous one, that is in the first chemical property that I was talking about, when boron was treated with oxygen, But in air, we see nitrogen is also present. But this reaction I have made it separately so as to make you understand that is whenever boron is being treated with nitrogen and we have to heat it, because as we have talked about the chemical as well as physical property of boron also, that is, it is a very hard material. So therefore, we have to heat it. And so in this case, basically, boron nitride is being produced. So therefore, this is what we have. It is boron nitride. So this happens when a boron is treated with nitrogen. So there are also few chemical properties that I want to talk about. And the next one is reaction of boron with carbon. So boron when treated with carbon, it forms boron carbide. Similarly, it is if we heat calcium in presence of carbon, then we could get calcium carbide. So but calcium is the one which is belonging to the S block. So here also we are talking about a P block element, and that is also of group 13 element, the first element of group 13. And that is basically boron. And so this is when boron is treated with carbon, so as we could get boron nitride, that has a molecular formula of B4C. So this is what I want to talk about, and let us move on to the next one. So there are many chemical properties that I want to talk about. So the next one is the reaction of boron with halogens. As you know that halogens are very much reactive, and in this case basically boron is also very much reactive to that of the halogen in this case, and that's the reason it forms boron trihalide. So in this case, this X, this means the halogen molecule, and this could be fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine also. So whenever a boron is been treated with a particular halogen, then the boron trihalide is been formed. And this boron trihalide, since we are talking about boron trihalide, let me talk about in a very few detail. As you know that the boron has a valency of, or we could say with the help of electronic configuration, we could mention the electronic configuration as 2s2 2p1. So in this case we could say that the valence electron of that is boron is 3. And that now suppose if I consider any of the halogen atom, and suppose if I am talking about that is fluorine, which is basically F9. So I could write the electronic configuration as that is 1s2 2s2 2p5. So if I talk about the orbitals, so in this case basically the s orbital is completely different. I talk about the p orbital, so p orbitals will also be filled in this manner, that is according to Hund's rule, 1 2 3 4 and 5. So again here we could see that is one unpaired electron is been present, so therefore we could also say that is fluorine has a valency of 1. So in this case since the boron trichloride or boron trifluoride or is been formed, so it forms a very stable structure. So let me talk about the structure of it in terms of Lewis structure. So this is what we have got to know, that is the fluorine atom also has a valency of 1. So let me discuss about the Lewis structure of BX3. Suppose if you are talking about especially about BF3. So since we know that according to Lewis structure I am talking about, that is the boron has a valency of 3, so I could represent it in this way, where this dot represents the valence electron of boron. While talking about the other one, that is suppose if I am talking about fluorine, so therefore fluorine will have an valency of 1, but in terms of that is when we talk about the valence electron, so in this case we will get to know that fluorine is the one that has basically it will have 7 electron in its valence shell. So it implies with every fluorine atom, so this is what I am going to talk about, and this cross it represents the electron of that is the valence electron of fluorine. So this is how I am representing it. But if you talk about the octet, so is it obeying an octet rule? No, it is actually it is the molecule which is having less number of that is electrons, so as to give a stable electronic configuration. That means we need 8 electrons to fulfill a complete octet. But in this case, if you observe, then the total number of electrons around the boron is basically 6, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you consider this 6 electrons, so this is less than 8. So thereby, we could say that BF3 is actually an electron deficient molecule. So that is the, because it is an electron deficient molecule, so that has a capacity to accept the lone pair of electron or to accept a shared pair of electron toward itself. So that's the reason it acts like Lewis acid. So most of the, salts or most of the halogens whenever we are obtaining, that is whether it will be BF3, whether it will be BCl3, or even that is AlCl3. So they are basically Lewis acids, and that's the reason they are used in that is Friedel-Crafts reaction. So this was one of the property that I was going to talk about, and that's it. So this was related to the one where we have represented the reaction of the halogen with that of the boron. So now let us move on to the next one, and that is the reaction of boron with mineral acid. So boron actually is very much reactive with that of the mineral acids, and those mineral acids would be like HCl, HNO3 and H2SO4. But talking about the HCl, whenever an HCl is reacted with boron, because boron, if in its crystalline form, it doesn't react with that of an acid. That's the reason we can't get any kind of product. But if we reacted with other mineral acids like HNO3 or like H2SO4, then the following product have been obtained. So let me talk about that one also. So in this case, basically, when boron is created with that is 3 moles of nitric acid, then the product that we could obtain is basically boric acid along with that of 3 moles of NO2 gas. So similarly, if we react boron with that of that is sulfuric acid, then the product that we could obtain is again a boric acid, but in this case the byproduct that we could obtain is 3 moles of SO2. So this is how basically even the mineral acids are very much reactive with that of the boron, except the HCl, it doesn't react with the crystalline boron. So that is something different property of boron that is being exhibited. And so this was something related to reaction of boron with that of mineral acid. And let us move on to the last one that I'm going to talk about, and that is reducing action of boron. So boron is actually a very powerful reducing agent, and that's reason it has a capacity to basically reduce a particular substance. So let me give the example through this reaction that I mentioned over here. That is, suppose if we react boron with that of the carbon dioxide, and since as I mentioned earlier, that is boron is the one which is a very good or very powerful that is reducing agent, so therefore it will try to grab the oxygen to itself. So in this case, basically if I talk about that is boron, so whenever boron is treated with carbon dioxide, so it will take all the oxygen to itself. That's the reason the product that will form is basically boron oxide, that is B2O3. So thereby this carbon dioxide has undergone through reduction process, and that's the reason we obtain 3 moles of carbon. So this is indicating that boron is actually a very powerful reducing agent, and reduction is the one that we know, that is reduction is the one that is the addition of hydrogen or the removal of oxygen. So in this case, basically it is acting like a reduction process has been going on. And so it is not applicable to only carbon, but there is another reaction that I want to talk about, that is whenever the boron is treated with silicon dioxide, that is SiO2. Even this is undergoing a reduction process, and that's the reason that the boron is a powerful reducing agent. It will try to grab all the oxygen atom to itself, and that's the reason that the product will be formed is that is B2O3, that is a boron oxide, and the byproduct that is what we have to obtain is silicon. So this is what an oxide of a particular nonmetal would be converted into a pure element, like in this case it is carbon, and in this case it is silicon. So this also shows a different chemical property of boron that was not been mentioned earlier. So this is what I want to talk about the different chemical as well as the physical properties of the boron, and that's it. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you have understood this very, very clearly, and you have got to know the concept of what is the physical and what are the chemical properties that have been exhibited by boron. So that's it. And I hope you'll share this video with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe. Make it a channel. Thank you so much.